everyone. As Francesco mentioned, my name is Matteo, and we're here going to be talking about bridging the generational gap, or bridging the gen gap for short. Now, just to give you a quick background about myself and what we are. So, as I mentioned, my name is Matteo, and I'm from an organization called Shoutout UK. We're a multi-award-winning educational platform and creative social enterprise that fuses education and tech to try and teach young people about political and media literacy. And political literacy being the kind of understanding the bare-bone basics around how our democracy functions. So in the UK context, understanding, you know, what is the House of Lords, how an MP gets elected, what is first past the post, all the bare-bone basics around how our system works. As well as media literacy, which some of you might be aware, is how to critically analyze the information we receive online, as well as offline radio, TV, etc. And through our work, we engage quite a lot with what people call Generation Z, or the next generation, and I'll ask you a couple of questions. I'm going to do a couple of quizzes as to what you think Generation Z think about, as well as what you think that means. So just going through the agenda today, you can all see this. So we're going to understand what Gen Z is and who they are, reviewing recent data trends for Gen Z, looking at live examples to support engaging Gen Z, and then we're going to do a hackathon where we're going to lead some audience-led problem solving to you guys. Are going to help everybody else, as well as yourselves, understand how you can better engage with Gen Z, with your individual NGOs. Because we're quite a close group today, I think there's about 15 people on the call at the moment, it would be great to start off with some introductions. So if you want to, and you want to share who you are, your name, as well as a brief one-liner about what your organization does, as well as its name, then please request to share your audio and video, and Francesco, I'm sure, will be able to give you access so you can share that live. If you don't feel comfortable with that, then please feel free to add your name as well as your organization and a quick one-liner about what they do in the chat. So I'm going to give you a couple of seconds. For those of you who've just joined, if you would like to share what your organization does, as well as what you are, one-liner about your organization, then please feel free to share your audio and video. And if you don't feel comfortable with that, then please feel free to start typing and writing your name, as well as your organization, and a quick one-liner about what they do in the chat. Our first person, Olga, hello.
Hello. Hello, I'm Olga.
Sorry, hi.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yep, we can hear you. We can hear you. Go ahead.
Yeah, I'm Olga from Warsaw, and I'm working in an NGO, and our most important aim is to empower young people in public space and give them more voice and more influence on important issues like school, local administration, local governance. Yeah.
Amazing. Amazing, amazing. Very much. Thank you, Olga, and thank you for joining us today. Anybody else? Again, all you have to do is share your audio and video, and Francesca will set you up. And again, if you don't feel comfortable, you can, of course, write it in the chat, your name and the organization that you're from, as well as a one-liner about what they do, what you do, rather. Anybody else? No? A couple of people lingering? A couple of shy ones? No? Okay. All right, then. Let's move swiftly along. Oh, here we go. Ah, fantastic. A couple of texts coming in. So, Marcela Vinuela, I am from Argentina. Welcome. Living in Berlin. Wow. My NGO is Mar de Colores EV. We work with migrant children, mostly from Latin America. Amazing. By the way, apologies. I might end up butchering some of these names, so I'm going to apologize straight away from from the get-go. Hello, I'm Adina. I coordinate Youngsters for Europe, which organizes activities for young people and adults, as well as through non-formal education techniques on local level and international level. Sounds amazing. Kia Rashid, Palestine, Sports for Life, an NGO that uses sports to teach youth life skills and bringing awareness on societal issues. Amazing, amazing, amazing. And Adina from Romania, incredible, incredible. Thank you very much for that. Another one, Diana, good morning. I'm from Forum Apulum, I believe. A grassroots NGO from Romania focused on empowering younger generations using media literacy. Amazing, amazing, amazing. Another media literacy organization. And civic education. Diana, I think we need to chat. I'm from Slovenia, says Taja. I work in a community space in one neighborhood. So there are people from all ages. Incredible. Hi, I'm Aga from Warsaw. I work for... Aga, if you wouldn't mind, you can come on and share your audio and video and say the name of your organization. You say in English, Receipt for Independence. Amazing. We empower young adults from foster care through cooking. Incredible. That's interesting. Very unique angle. And we definitely need to chat. Fantastic. Yes, please. Right. Amazing. Some incredible, incredible organizations. So, unless anybody else wants to share their audio and video and quickly have a quick minute to talk about their organization. And Francesca will unlock you if there's anybody else. No? Last couple of seconds. Speak now, forever hold your peace. No? All right, fantastic. Cool. So what is Gen Z? I'm going to ask you all the question. You can write into the chat right now. So what is Gen Z or Generation Z? What does that mean to yourselves as an audience? What does it mean to you? Feel free to write in the chat as to what you think Gen Z means. What does it stand for? What kind of demographic? Does anyone know the age group that this refers to? I'm a member of Gen Z, apparently. Fantastic. Fantastic. Anybody else? Young adults born after 1997. Okay. So research and popular media use mid to late 1990s, the starting birth year, and the early 2000s and end birth year for Generation Z, or Gen Z for short. It's the demographic that succeeds the millennials, that comes after the millennials. So yeah, 1996, 1997 is indeed correct. So a couple of quick quiz questions for you all, if you might be aware. So what is the percentage of Gen Zers that are optimistic about their personal future? Let's start off with that one. What do you think? Also known as the digitalites. Yes, indeed. 15%, 15%. A lot of people saying 15%. The answer is, of course, there we go. It is actually 88%. It's actually 88%. 88% of Gen Zs are actually positive or optimistic about their future, which I found very interesting because I was actually going to go with what yourself said about 15%. I didn't know it was going to be that high. The millennials are definitely a lot more pessimistic. In fact, the millennials are on the other end of that scale, and which is why it's so interesting to see such a massive generational switch between the millennials and Gen Z. Next question: what percentage of Gen Zers think school has prepared them for the future? What percentage do you think of Gen Zers think school have prepared them for the future? 5%, quite a lot of 5%. Okay. The answer is 57%. Francisco, for the win, it is indeed 57%. 57% of Gen Zers think school has prepared them for the future, which again is in stark contrast to the millennial generation, which is again quite a lot lower. Marcella, shocked face twice. Yes, I mean, when we were doing research for this, it's actually quite shocking the difference, the sheer stark difference between the millennial and the Gen Z generation. And as people that work in Gen Z, work in NGOs and in the NGO space, working with young people, it's important for us to understand where these different generations see themselves and how they see their future and helping them better navigate it. Finally, what percentage of Gen Z prefer brands contacting them on Instagram? I was hoping you guys didn't see that, but you clearly did. Yes, it is 73%. When we're talking about brands, 85%. No, it is 73%. It's quite interesting. And when we talk about brands, we don't just mean, obviously, corporate brands. It could be social enterprises. It could be charities. It could be any organization under the sun. Gen Z Instagram is one option, but they prefer social media and what is called direct contact. So they prefer brands connecting with them directly and having that more personal, almost human approach to marketing, to support, to whatever may be. So thank you very much for taking part in that. So quick looking at Gen Z at a glance. So 80% said they aspire to work with cutting edge technology. As someone mentioned before, they are, I love that term, digitalites, as Adina said. They love working with cutting edge technology. 80% of them do anyway. Unlike their millennial predecessors, Gen Z is motivated by financial incentives and career advancement more so than millennials. So it's actually more around financial incentives and career advancement, which again is quite interesting and should really be looked at when NGOs are engaging with, or when we are engaging with this specific generation. 90% said technology would influence job choice, which is an astonishing figure. And again, as people that work in or work for NGOs, it's important for us when we're hiring people from Gen Z, when we're going to be hiring people from Gen Z or supporting people from Gen Z, or even getting them to volunteer with us, it's important to bear in mind that the technology that we use and how technologically advanced we are as organizations will influence the likelihood of those young people wanting to engage with us as organizations. Gen Z will be the most educated generation, which is so interesting. And for me, seems kind of obvious, but a lot of people overlook this. This will be the generation that, by far in general, has gone primarily to university. They will have had a variety of different educational, from formal to informal. They view also informal education as a massive positive, which I think is of great benefit to NGOs. Like a lot of your NGOs help engage with young people through, say, you know, one was cooking, another was sport, etc. Young people and Gen Z specifically see that as a massive positive or a massive benefit. So if NGOs use this effectively, we can really engage that next generation in an incredibly interesting and positive way. So knowing all of this, how do we build meaningful relationships with this next generation, with Generation Z? So recruitment and engagement. And I wanted to break these different aspects up and start off with recruitment and engagement. As any good NGO, we're looking at recruiting the next generation that works with young people. We're looking at recruiting and then, of course, engaging those people, those young people that we've recruited. And one of the things to obviously bear in mind is understanding and to be what is called digital first. Now, this phrase is thrown around left, right, and center, and quite often doesn't mean much to people. But digital first basically means by creating a internal culture that embraces an agile approach to new ideas and changes as a force for good. So what this means is that rather than seeing technology as a negative or a potential problem, you bring it into your company or your NGO, your social enterprise's ethos as a force, as an ultimate force for good. Like, how can we use technological advancements to enforce or improve or enhance our mission statement? And just before we carry on, does anyone here want to sort of share their audio and video and talk about how their NGO maybe has used technology or a digital first approach to solving issues and bringing Gen Z's into the forefront? Anybody have any good examples? Or if you don't feel comfortable sharing your audio, please feel free to write it into the session chat. But it'd be great to hear something. Maybe Taja yourself, as a millennial yourself. No? Wait. Okay. We'll wait. We've got time. Okay. No problem. Well, while Taja resolves the audio problem, I'm going to carry on with the other aspects and you can come back to us. So another aspect of our recruitment and engagement is ensuring authenticity, and uniqueness in your approach. Now, the authenticity thing might seem obvious, but one of the things that we see with brands, NGOs, social enterprises, is this issue sometimes of authenticity. So don't just say you work with young people. Show that you work with young people. So what that means is that if you say you are youth-led, be that thing that you're saying that you are. So making sure that you have young people at the forefront of, say, your videos or your decision making to some extent, making sure that they actually have a real voice within your organization, not just a youth board that kind of advises but doesn't really have that authentic youth-led engagement approach. It may seem obvious, but there are organizations that sometimes struggle with that, especially when it's a youth board that is a volunteers. And therefore, having that direct link with decision makers can sometimes be potentially problematic or perceived as problematic. But making sure that you're authentic with what you're saying. So if you are saying that you're youth-led, making sure that you are genuinely youth-led and unique in your approach. Like making sure that you're not scared to have a unique view, even though someone else may not have tried it or. Another organization may not have utilized the approach you're doing. Don't be shy from trying to be unique. That's something that really resonates with Gen Z. Taja mentioned our organization doesn't use digital stuff, but I, as a member of Gen Z, try to implement that somehow, which just goes to show, again, when you have young people from that demographic, they are going to be more tech savvy just in general because they're born in the digital age. And it's important to include them within those discussions because they will know things and they will know trends that you, as someone that is older, may not know. Marcella says, this year we gave an empowerment and leadership workshop for girls with digital tools such as photography, video, and blogging. So blogs. Amazing, amazing, amazing. And, you know, giving them digital skills, which they can then use later on in life for career opportunities or whatever else, shows that you're authentically empowering that next generation. Not just saying that you're empowering them, but you are actually genuinely empowering them. Iga says, we're currently rebuilding our website and launching cooking tutorials on TikTok. That is a fantastic idea. I don't know if you guys are aware, or Iga, you probably are, but just for the benefit of everybody else, TikTok has launched a huge amount of both funding as well as opportunities and infrastructure around building educational brands on TikTok. So for example, a partner that we work with, the WWF, have launched a load of resources and videos and so forth on TikTok around understanding the environment, climate change, biodiversity, etc. So Igor, you know, going towards cooking tutorials on TikTok is a fantastic show of having that digital first approach. So not looking at TikTok as a problem per se. There are issues, don't get me wrong, but not looking at it as a whole, as a problem, but looking at how can we utilize that and embrace that technology, which frankly is here to stay, to better advance our mission. So that's an amazing example. Thank you, everyone, for those. And then finally, learn trends and ride them, but don't be cringe or cringy. For those of you who don't know what cringe means, is that don't be awkward about it, or don't place yourself on a trend that you clearly don't belong. So to give you one example of this is we see loads of brands jumping on the Black Lives Matter or BLM trend at the moment. And some brands who have a history of issues around racism and so forth, jumping on that trend is actually worse for them than not, because you don't belong on that trend. You haven't done anything towards that, towards the advancement or towards that movement. So why are you suddenly jumping on it? It's very obvious when you're jumping on something purely for the sake of social media or for the sake of marketing. So learning about trends and understanding them and writing them is important, but only if they fit your mission statement, and making sure that you jump on trends that you're actually contributing to. Because it is obvious otherwise, if you're jumping on trends that you frankly haven't done anything with or haven't done anything in engaging with. Diana says, in order to mentor students from all over the country, we are coordinating them almost entirely online, especially since the pandemic hit. And we have involved young people in the core team, decisional team. They are not only target audience, they are our partners. That is amazing. Diana, would you be interested in sharing your audio and video? Because I'd love to hear more about the coordination of it online. Specifically, I mean, reacting to the pandemic is something that I think all of us as people within NGOs can relate to being sometimes a struggle and sometimes an issue. Hi, Diana. Thank you so much for your message.
Hi.
Tell us a bit more about it.
Well, it's. I think you have to just shift your perspective when working with teenagers, because you don't. Adults tend to patronize them and to look at them like some category of public which is not so bright and not so exposed to new things, and don't understand that they are superficial. So once you understand that they are just like adults, some are more involved, some are not, some are more curious, some are not, you go on from there. And as I said, we are seeing them as partners, even if our NGO was funded by adults in the beginning, completely people over 25, let's say. Now we have in our core team teenagers and younger than 20 years old, and they're not just there for showing off. They are really, we consult with them every single day. They implement projects, they come up with ideas. And since the pandemic hit, I've seen that their interest into becoming coordinated or mentored exclusively online, it's even bigger than it was before. They're more interested in this. And we have in our team people we haven't met in person, never, ever. And we're working great with them. And or we have people we haven't seen in person for 1 year, and they're our members on paper. I mean, on legal papers, they're our members. So the pandemic opened a new bridge for us. Oh, no limits. We coordinate students who are studying in UK but are Romanians, so they are in our team. So geographical limits are no longer valid, and we should take advantage of that. And yes, we should forget the idea that we are the smartest and the brightest because we are older. So once you get over it, things just go smooth.
No, definitely. And yeah, getting over that, and frankly, that we're not as young as we all once were, unfortunately.
Exactly. Yeah.
which is a hard thing to realize sometimes.
Yeah.
But thank you so much.
Thank you
for that, Diana. And Aga, I was wondering if you could also maybe share your experience with TikTok and how you're launching a cooking tutorial, because I know we've we're moving on to TikTok as well as an organisation with Shoutout UK. And I was wondering how many organizations here are potentially moving on to TikTok or even Twitch, for example, if you want to do videos and if you're linking towards anything to do with gaming, for example. So Igor, I don't know if you could share how you guys came about launching cooking tutorials on TikTok and how that's going, if you've launched any yet. Oh, and then if Aga, you are still here. Cool. Whilst we potentially wait for Aga or anybody else that wants to share their story of how they're going potentially digital first, then please share your audio and video, and Francisco will of course unlock you and let you voice yourself. So whilst we're waiting for yourself or anybody else that wants to, feel free to jump in and share their experience and share their story. I wanted to share some of ours as an organization, some of what we're doing at the moment around digital first, as well as some of our projects. Well, one project and one aspect of digital first. So one thing that we've done and we've been doing since 2019 is for the creation of our e-portal. You'll be able to see a couple of screenshots on the share screen over there of our e-platform to deliver our programs. This is fully addressed for the next generation. Young people can learn either on phone, iPads, laptops, whatever else. It's you can use it in schools as well as on laptops at home. And the point of it was to try and, first of all, digitize all of our programs back in 2019. This is all pre-pandemic, into a unique platform that allowed for blended learning. So for individuals to either learn by themselves or to learn by themselves with a teacher supporting. So the teacher has their own account if a school subscribes, and then they will be able to input all of their students. So each individual student has their own account, which means that they can learn at home, at school, or whatever else. And this was all created in collaboration and with partnership with a bunch of focus groups from Gen Z young people across the UK. We were asking them how they wanted to learn. And one of the things that we found, especially in the UK, is that education in the UK can be quite archaic, can be quite, for lack of a better term, backward, in the sense that UK schools struggle to build in or implement new technology. But once we started speaking to and giving this next generation a platform to say, well, what do you want? What would you want to see in terms of political and media literacy education? It was so interesting to see what came back around the use of videos and graphic cartoons, the use of interactive quizzes. Gamification came up loads. So ensuring that these things are gamified and interesting as you're going through ensures that it's an interesting and a different way to learn to the standard teacher telling you and then you regurgitating the information. But it does have a much higher impact in terms of engagement as well as social impact later on. So utilizing social media, yes, is a great way to engage, but also making sure that your own tools and your own delivery methods and your own programs also embrace that digital approach, be it through, obviously, in Aga's case, tutorials on TikTok, but also seeing how you can implement that within your own structures, if that's something that you'd like to do, and making sure that it's malleable so that those young people can learn in the devices and in the settings that best suit their needs. And learning on mobile is something that's becoming more and more sought after. People learning via YouTube videos or on TikTok or on Instagram or whatever else is becoming a massive trend, and has been a massive trend for a while. So understanding that and jumping on that trend is important for NGOs, especially if you're on a educational or engagement setting. Another example, which is ever so slightly different, moving away from that digital first aspect, more so around the engagement, is utilizing influencers and people that those young people look up to. And one example that we did was a collaboration with Drill Minister. So in December 2019, just to give yourselves a bit of context, in December 2019, we in the UK had a general election. And just before general elections, we often have voter registration drives, because for some reason we need to register to vote as opposed to just being registered at birth to vote. Whole other conversation. Anyway, so we need to register to vote if you've changed address or whatever else, especially. And often this means that different organizations run voter registration drives to make sure that those most underrepresented within our politics aren't left out of the conversation. And we decided to team up with this drill rapper, so a musician called Drill Minister, to create a track, a drill track in the, on and a music video, basically on registering to vote and the importance of the vote. And we were using or engaging with Drill Minister to ensure that young people that listen to drill music, that often were seen as the most socioeconomically disadvantaged, or the ones that were least likely to engage with the system, to basically utilize a method that they listen to already and they engage with already to get them talking about politics. So rather than expecting them to come to us and talk to us about politics, we went to them in a medium that they liked, that they engaged with already, and that they enjoyed. And this video, when we created the music track and so forth, ended up on Mixtape Madness, which is a YouTube channel with several million subscribers, as well as SBTV, which is a massive online TV station in the UK, specifically focused on grime and drill music. And then Unilad Sound. Some of you may have heard of Unilad. Unilad Sound has about 6 million likes and followers on, I think, Facebook alone. And the response was incredible. As you can see here some of the tweets and engagements. It's incredible to see that it wasn't just young people that we ended up engaging with. Some people were saying that they, you know, hadn't voted in the last 20 years, and now they decided to finally start voting again. So we ended up, by accident, not just engaging with Gen Z, but specifically with Gen Z, it really resonated and it helped improve the level of voter registration and therefore voter turnout amongst that younger demographic. Obviously, in the UK, being able to register at 16 and then being able to vote at 18, that was seen as really important. And I was wondering if any of yourselves, I'm going to throw the question back, any of yourselves have some examples of how you potentially engage with trends to help push your mission, and rather than expecting those young people to come to you, you've gone to them utilizing those trends. Again, if you want to share your audio and video, I'm sure Francesca will be able to unlock you. If there's anyone that would like to share an experience or a case study that they've had, that they've used. Taj says, however, I wonder if the use of digital can embrace the connections from different culture, ages, and so on, as the physical community space does, because not everyone has the opportunity, the knowledge, the device to engage in this kind of activities. Of course, no, definitely. Initiative where to learn about it and apply with the idea. Are there ethical dilemmas in working with TikTok? How is their moderation doing in terms of protecting youth from hate and harassment? Both fantastic points. Taja, I'm wondering if you've resolved your audio issue. Maybe you could come on and talk about how the use of digital can embrace the connection between different cultures, ages. Because intergenerational divide, I mean, in the UK, I know is a massive issue, but it's a massive issue across the globe. And for us, technology is definitely a way to resolve that, bringing older and younger people together to discuss issues, talk about the different problems that the older generation are facing as well as the younger generation are facing, is more important now probably than it ever has been. There is a massive intergenerational conflict at the moment, and the use of technology, especially with this blended learning, where you've got young people that can actually support and help older people understand technology better, and older people passing on their expertise. Taja, hello.
Hi, I think I resolved my issue.
Fantastic, welcome.
Yeah, well, I think I'm a member of Generation Z, and I always wondered how I can implement this kind of stuff in our community space. However, I always have this dilemma that the connections and the opportunities are not for everyone, because I work with the youth and also some older people who don't know how to use the technology. However, we know the technology is very available for everyone, but not everyone can use it. So there is always my issue and wondering if I'm not excluding someone. So we didn't use this kind of stuff.
Yeah.
But as you said, you need to have some unique approach to this. So maybe we need to find ours.
Yeah, no, definitely. And I think, I mean, it is a very valid point, your one. It is a difficult one because what you don't want to do, especially if you're dealing with multiple generations in your project, what you don't want to do is accidentally exclude a whole group of the older demographic and then favor the younger generation. You want to make sure you have a balanced approach. And how do you achieve that? And for me, the best way of doing that is that intergenerational dialogue, or that intergenerational, I can't remember the correct term for it. I mean, it's the idea of cross-learning, you know, where the older generation have certain knowledge and stuff that they've picked up that they can pass down to young people, whereas young people have the tech savviness that the older generation lack. Mm-hmm. And that kind of cross-pollination can really build bridges. So something around that, I think, would be quite powerful if you are trying to balance those two generations together. But it is an issue, something that we need to bear in mind. What you don't want to do again is exclude a whole heap of people for the sake of.
Because if you're physical there in the community, you open a space that everyone can come and live as they wish. And so with the digital, maybe someone doesn't see us, but I don't know. The COVID situation forced us to close our spaces and to find a new way to engage with the neighborhood.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. No, definitely. Thank you very much, Taja. I'm so glad that you managed to sort out your audio.
Yeah.
Zora, I was wondering if you'd like to come on and talk about your. Was it Zoran? Oh, no, Diana. Sorry, my bad. Diana, you were talking about a mentorship program right now named Civic Influencers, in which you help the teens become influencers in their own communities. So in this way, we reach young people from various towns through authentic messages. Diana, I was wondering if you'd like to come on and share your audio and video and kind of share that solution, because I think again that we used an influencer that already existed in terms of Drill Minister, but building your own or helping them become influencers in their own community or leaders in their own community is a fantastic alternative.
Yeah,
I'd love to hear more about that.
We figure out that we know what messages we want to deliver as an NGO, and we know that we want them to be informed and involved, but we shouldn't always try to bend our minds in thinking of messages which seem appealing to them. And we should just tell them, create a mentorship program, tell them what to educate them, help them get to the information they need, and invest in them so they can become influencers online. So we don't have to think about new platforms or new shapes of delivering the message. They will deliver the message wherever they feel comfortable. So they made the mixture of online and offline events, in, of course, with safety measures and everything, and they are much more credible than we would be because they are in the same generation. So this works. I mean, this works very well for us because we have a new generation of community leaders. We have them in almost half of the country spread around in smaller towns or bigger towns. And also we use the big advantage that this year the university students are staying at home mostly. So they're not in big university centers. They're in small towns and small communities, hanging around on Zooms in classes, but they have some free time to get connected with these small towns. And with our help of investing financially in the promotion and all that stuff, they reach more and more people. So I think this could be a way. Why should we become civic influencers when we're not Generation Z, but help them become empowered and give voice?
Yeah, no, definitely. And that's an amazing alternative in terms of rather than finding influencers that already exist in that generation, helping the young people that you're already engaging with to become influencers themselves.
Yeah.
And obviously there's a bit more almost time investment in that because you're developing. But then again, if you're trying to empower that generation, what more empowering than building community leadership, essentially? That's a fantastic example. Thank you so much for that, Deanna. Zoran, as Francesco said, all contributions are important. We'd love to hear your question. Do please share your audio and video when you're fantastic.
Okay.
Straight off the mark. Hello.
Hello, hello. You know, TikTok is still very new for us older people. So I wonder about your insight about TikTok, how appropriate it is to work on it, how well they do protect their users. It was a topic this morning, you know, hate speech and harassment. So a quick Google search shows that there are some problems, but I don't know, I don't really know much about it, so I wanted to learn more.
No, sure, definitely, Zoran, thank you so much for that. And yes, there are problems with TikTok, like with a lot of different social media platforms, in terms of harassment, in terms of bullying, in terms of trolling. I would say that with TikTok, it's their algorithm is still problematic. There's been loads of stories around how they prioritize certain people by the way they look or whatever else. So it is an issue. It definitely is an issue. But the reality is, of course, is that young people are on this platform. And you don't have to necessarily put the young people that you work with on the platform, but you can, as someone mentioned earlier, for example, do a cooking video or put animations on there, because it is, in the end, a tool. And unfortunately, like with any tool, it can be used in either way. There are massive issues. But if you're using it for the sake of engaging with that generation who, frankly, are already on there, you not using it is not going to stop young people from using the platform. They're still going to use it. They're just not going to have access to your content. They're going to have access to someone else's. So if you're attempting to empower the next generation and engage with them, they're on this platform. So I think it'd be a shame if you didn't engage with it because you thought there were issues with it. There are, don't get me wrong. There definitely are. And a lot of social media companies have issues in terms of trolling and so forth. So you do have to bear in mind safeguarding when it comes to young people, that if you are going to put young people on there, if you are going to put a conversation with young people on there, you do need to bear in mind all those things that you would bear in mind anywhere if you're in an offline setting or if you're on Twitter or Facebook or Instagram or Snapchat or wherever else. So as long as you have those same safeguardings in place, there is no harm making sure to utilize that platform, because that is one of the predominant platforms for this generation we're talking about. And it would be a shame not to use it. There are issues. There are issues with social media in general, especially when it comes to mental health. But these are the platforms that they're on. So I think whether we like it or not, we do have to engage these platforms. But thank you so much, Zoran, for that question. I hope I came a little bit in a way of answering that question. So moving on to collaboration to retain and grow that audience. And it's important to remember that once we recruit and engage with these audiences, this next generation, it's also important to understand how to retain that same audience and then grow and utilize that audience to make sure that you grow and keep engaging. Tajan just mentioned that was quite important. The young people are already using the platform. We need to give them opportunity to experience it in different ways. Thank you very much, Tajan. Be genuinely youth-led, something that I've mentioned before, and a couple of you already talked about it. I think it was Deanna, I believe, who talked about civic influencers and helping young people become influencers themselves and then utilize those skills to then go to their own generation. So being authentically, genuinely youth-led, I cannot stress that enough. Making sure that young people can see themselves in your brand, can see themselves in what you are doing. So making sure that you engage with young people in the best ways possible by ensuring that young people are talking to young people peer-to-peer. So young people to young people peer-to-peer is probably one of the best ways of ensuring retention and growth. If they see themselves in your organization, then they will be more likely to stick around. You'll be more likely to retain that audience and then obviously grow said audience. Support those you already engage so they feel empowered and help grow your own community. So essentially, again, talking about that civic engagement or getting them involved, for example, in those cooking tutorials on TikTok. All of these things help empower that generation by helping them create their own content, utilizing your expertise as an NGO. But at the same time, having their face on there, showing that it's young people leading young people. Again, peer-to-peer is probably one of the most powerful. Because again, if we go back to the beginning of the presentation, Gen Z appreciate brands talking to them directly on social media. But if we were to go further than that, they also appreciate those brands being youth-focused, being youth-led, making sure there is a youth message within what you're talking about with a young person at the forefront. And then one last thing, and again, this might be a bit of an issue for NGOs, but again, it's important to know about these trends and then utilize them the best way possible to ensure that what you're trying to do, either be it empowering, cooking, football, whatever it may be, ensuring that you are engaging them in the way that that resonates with them. So social good for the sake of it doesn't cut it anymore, unfortunately. Unless it's a major topic like climate change or potentially mental health now, social good just for the sake of social good is not good enough. You need to push that further and be like, okay, you're gonna improve this social lane, but at the same time, you're learning these skills that can potentially advance your career in this way, give you life skills, blah, 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 all these different aspects. There needs to be something that benefits them directly rather than just the social mission as a whole. Obviously, big issues like climate change and mental health and things like that transcend this because of how global and catastrophic these situations are. But in general, social good just for that in itself just doesn't cut it anymore. So we need to have more than that. You need to really push those messages of, if you support us with this, you're going to get this other life skill. Doing this program is helping your community get a voice, but you're also building your leadership skills, your confidence building, your emotional resilience, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So making sure that there is that kind of two-way street of improving that social mission, but at the same time gaining those valuable skills that they can take on later on in life. And finally, collaborations. Partnerships are probably, first of all, massively underrated. And sometimes NGOs, because we are quite often competing for funding sometimes, we are potentially so stuck in our own mission, we tend to forget that there is a whole other world of the third sector or NGOs that you need to collaborate with, and that if you do collaborate with, you can make for stronger projects, stronger bids. There are certain things that other NGOs do better than yourself, and then there's certain things that you do better than other NGOs. And having that collaboration is something that, first of all, funders really appreciate. But at the same time, make sure that you have a bigger, more wholesome offer for the young people that you're trying to engage with. These are just some examples of some of our partners, for example, and they range from universities to youth clubs. We worked with a for-profit organization called Kidzania, which some of you may know about, which is a much younger demographic that we tend to deal with. But for them, it gives them an opportunity to offer something different to the kids that they deal with. And for us, it gave us an opportunity to expand and get more of the word out to parents that we work with. And I was wondering if any of you would like to share some good partnership examples that you may have had of either a successful project going on with certain bids, or a potential unlikely partnership which ended up going quite well. Again, if you want to share your story or share your case study, please feel free to share your audio and video for those of you who just joined, and Francisco will be able to unlock you, so to speak, for lack of a better term. Anybody have good partnership stories or partnership experiences? I mean, we can't all have had bad partnership experiences. There must be some of you that may have had good partnership experiences. I mean, one, whilst we're waiting for someone to jump on, was with the University of Sheffield. We've worked with them now for about a good part of about 3 years now. And with them, we work with their academics. And one of the things that they work with is that they do a lot of social science research, so research around politics and so forth. And they consistently struggle engaging with young people, so specifically Gen Z, so not university students, but young people pre-university in early secondary school. And we work with them on a number of projects to help them engage with that demographic. And we've partnered together on research grants that we would never have been able to apply for, money we would never have been able to unlock if we were just applying for it directly ourselves. But with an academic organization, it gives you access to a whole plethora of other potential funding streams. At the same time, it helps the university because it means that they do the outreach that they're, as a sector, consistently criticized of not doing. Making sure that your research is not just for other academics, but making sure your research is for a wider audience and engaged with by loads of different young people. So that was a mutually beneficial partnership from them on the research side of things, and for us in terms of expanding our reach and working with other organizations and with other funders that we wouldn't normally have engaged with. Anybody? No? All right. If you do think of any good partnership ideas or partnership opportunities that you've had or that you've experienced or that you've seen, feel free to please write them in the chat. And one of the things before we go into the hackathon, where I think I've talked more than enough, and I'm gonna pass it back to you guys, we're all gonna hack the issue of how to help your individual NGOs engage with the next generation, with Gen Z. I want to talk about one last thing, which is about giving Gen Z what they are worth, which is may sound obvious, but sometimes us is a one-way street where we offer these programs, or we offer these, Dan has just come in. We are using also history as a tool for civic education, and we have several projects made in collaboration with historians and also visual artists. Now, that is a fantastic way of collaboration. Visual artists obviously make it easier or have a different way of engaging with that audience, and obviously historians have a wealth of knowledge that we in the NGO sector might not necessarily have. So bringing that together, and obviously for the historians, much like with the academics that we're talking about with Sheffield, they have this wealth of knowledge, but don't necessarily have that level of engagement. Hello, Francisco.
Hello. I'm just trying to fix some technical issue we have with our graphic illustrator, so I don't want to interrupt you. Like, go ahead without like.
Okay. Fantastic. No problem. Thank you. Cool. So yes, thank you very much, Diana, for that brilliant example. So what do I mean by giving Gen Z what they are worth? Many organizations want young people to write for them for exposure or experience. And this is specifically to do with youth news networks or youth blogs, for example. But you can take that example to a variety of different places. And there was a trend, for example, in the UK at the moment in 2015, where there were loads of these youth blogs popping up, or bigger NGOs or social enterprises or charities setting up blogs and asking young people to write for them. And this was quite often very clearly to show to others and potential funders and to other NGOs and young people that they were giving young people a voice, but often asking them to write for free about issues that the NGO wanted them to write about. And the idea was that the young people were being given exposure, or this idea of, well, we're publishing your work and therefore you can get exposed to other things and other opportunities, etc. That doesn't work and doesn't really fly. It's young people often see when they are potentially being used by the organization as a method of showcasing other young people, or use as a marketing gimmick or a marketing tool. It's important to ensure, if you want to retain these young people, that you give them what they are worth. One example from our aspect is that we retain our young writing community, our writer community, because we pay our best writers. So young people that pitch and do really, really good pitches get paid for their time. It's not a huge amount, but it's something to get them, first of all, started off in the world of journalism and showing that their word, their article is potentially worth something. But at the same time, it retains them also because they know that there is value in what they're doing, and they feel like there is value in what they're doing. And obviously, it doesn't necessarily have to be a paid-for thing. Also, depending on the demographic and the age that you're dealing with, you might be able to do that. But it is something that is very much worthwhile to consider when you're dealing with a demographic. Like, what can you give back of value if you are giving these young people the opportunity to come on your platform? So in which case, obviously, there's marketing there for yourself or for your own organization. But what is there? What is the give back quite often in those situations? So it's a very key thing to think about. And before we jump into the hackathon, does anyone have any shared experiences where they've had that two-way street and that's been successful, or potentially someone that hasn't worked, that was very much a one-way street where the young people just dropped off just purely because they didn't see that give back? I mean, does anyone have any examples they would like to share? You can share it, obviously, by typing in the chat, or you can share your audio and video and have a vocal share, a vocal conversation. Anyone want to share a story where they've had that two-way street, that collaboration? Again, you can write it in the chat if you don't feel comfortable coming on video. No? Okay. Well, if there are any ideas or any examples that come to mind, please feel free to write them in the chat. I'm sure we'll all find them incredibly, incredibly useful moving forward. And I did see one bit of a question that I completely missed out. My apologies. I think it was Zoran as well. Just to Zoran, if you're still with us, I will add the link for the TikTok educational initiative in the chat at the very end of the session. So if you are fantastic, great. So if you hang on at the end, I will I'll quickly find the link and dump it in the chat. For anybody else that's interested as well, I will add that in the chat. I don't know if the fund is still open, and I don't know what they're doing with the initiative, because it is I think a year old or something now. But it's a good little link to have a look at what they're doing, because all these tech platforms are moving towards an educational focus. So it's good to see what TikTok's doing, which is potentially something that YouTube and other organizations are potentially moving towards. So it's a good thing to bear in mind. So apologies, Zoran, for missing that. But yeah, I'll add that in the link. So, hackathon time. Just for your understanding, a hackathon is audience-led problem solving. So I've done quite a bit of talking, as you can probably imagine. So I'm going to leave it down to yourselves in the next portion last portion of this workshop to help us all together hack this issue of how can you engage with Gen Z, you as an individual, you as an organization that you either work for or run. How can we together help all of us solve this issue and leave the workshop better prepared to engage this next demographic? But I say general election, you can clearly tell what's on my mind. So how will we be doing this? So we're going to find the barriers to our topic. Now, the way we're going to work this, and I've never done it before this way, but we're all going to stay in this group together, and you're going to be writing your barriers and then solutions in the group chat. So the group chat is going to get hopefully a little aggressively vocal in a bit. So we're going to look at the barriers initially. So what are the barriers to engaging with this demographic? So one of it could be around the issues or the worries around TikTok, for example, as Zoran mentioned. One of the barriers could be a lack of understanding around tech in the leadership of an organization. Another barrier could be a lack of financial ability to build these platforms or to engage with these new initiatives, for example. So these barriers, I mean, they're all unique to everybody, but let's go through all those barriers together in a second. Then we're going to find solutions to each of those barriers. Now, you don't have to stick to your barrier. You can find solutions to any barrier mentioned by anybody previously. So then we're going to debate our solutions, and hopefully all of us are going to go away with one solution that we are pledging to take back to our NGO, and that can help push us along to better engagement with that next generation. All sound good? I can't hear any of you, so I'm presuming you're all saying yes. So we're going to start off with the barriers. Fantastic, Marcela, thank you. Yes, you can definitely have a link to the presentation as a PDF. I will send it across probably via the Game Changer Camp organizers at some point. But yes, I'll definitely share that across. Not a problem. So going into the major barriers, one thing I'd like you guys to do now is have a quiet think now, just yourself for a minute, and then write down every single major barrier to the topic in question. And the topic right now is, how can you, as an organization, engage with Gen Z? What are the barriers stopping you from doing that effectively? Diana's hot off the mark with lack of time to manage social media accounts. That is a consistent problem. And if my colleague who deals with our social media, Spencer, was on here, he would 100% back you on that, Diana. The level of time that it takes to run social media accounts properly is a madness. Very, very good point. Marcela, lack of interest in digital media on the part of children and fear on the part of parents. This is specifically Germany, Marcela, you mentioned, but that's actually something that I think is across all countries. I don't think that's necessarily specific to Germany. I mean, it's definitely in the UK as well. Digital media, not so much. So lack of interest in digital media on the part of the kids, not so much. Young people in the UK are definitely into digital. Scarily so when you see young kids with smartphones consistently. But fear on the parents is definitely a massive issue. Like, parents are definitely fearful, and to some extent for good reason. In terms of online safety, mental health, etc., is definitely a massive issue. So thank you, Marcela, for that barrier. And when there's 19 of you on here, I want to have a major barrier from all of you. At least one. Again, have a think with yourself. Like, what are the barriers that are stopping you and your organization from engaging with Gen Z? And it may be a case that your organization is doing really well in engaging Gen Z, but what's stopping you from doing better? Is there anything stopping you from doing better? There's always a way that we can improve. And if there's a way that we can improve, there is often something, a barrier that we need to overcome to help us improve. So what would that improvement be? So Taja, again, another lack of time and knowledge to manage social media accounts. Also, what kind of topics would be interesting and how to include them? Which is a very important point. Like, what kind of topics should we, them as the youth, of course. So what kind of topics would be of interest? Like, there are so many topics under the sun. And it may seem obvious because the topic could be, well, it's me, my organization, it's my topic. But of course, the reality is that, well, if it's the topic your organization's focusing on, how are you going to make that interesting to that next generation? And that's probably the more difficult part. Another one from Diana, the ever-changing algorithms on social media platforms. My God, yes. Definitely. When Google changed their algorithm, for example, not just on social media, but on search engines, when Google changed their algorithm and that completely changed the way Google's front page worked, for example. So there was an NGO that would be getting, you know, tons of hits from the front page of Google, suddenly were getting no hits. In the same way, you know, Facebook changing their algorithm to prioritize things that keep you on the platform. Twitter doing the exact same, Instagram very much in the exact same, understanding that, you know, certain short static videos are important. Another thing, for example, for me as a barrier is the different assets required for social media. So understanding that you can't just have one video. You need to have a video, then a minute long video, or under a minute long video for Instagram. Then you have another video that's more like a phone for Instagram stories. So all of these kind of things then start to pile up. Like, all of that's costly to build all these different types of assets for the different platforms. For me, that's definitely a barrier that we face, that we come across. Kaja also says the reason behind the using digital approach is educating, giving them space to express, give them voice. Yep. Alan, grabbing their attention in 1-2 seconds due to the generally reduced attention span, endless scroll of death as well. Yes, 100%. 100%. Couldn't agree with you more. So, another one, Olga. For youth workers, using inadequate, For youth workers, using inadequate adult language or trying to be cool, both equally as cringy. Yes, Taja, being cringe or trying to be cool, couldn't agree with you more. Trying to be cool or hip or down with the kids is probably some of the worst things I've ever seen. It is a problem. It's again, you're trying to connect with that generation, but it can come across the complete opposite way that you'd potentially like it to. Because you're not from that generation, so it just comes across as a bit strange. And then on the flip side, using adult language that they may not relate to or understand is equally as problematic. So making sure you have that delicate balance is important. Right, fantastic. I think that's more than enough in terms of barriers. Let's get out of this negativity and move on to the, we've done that already. So looking at the solutions, and we're going to have a chance now to share some of those solutions. So what I'd like you all to do is for 2 minutes, write down every single solution to any barrier that's just been mentioned that you can think of. Now, whenever we do this offline and we do this with young people, we normally call this creatively vomiting your ideas. Now, for anyone that's eaten their breakfast or lunch, I apologize. But the idea is that you're bringing out any idea that you can possibly imagine. No idea is crazy. No idea is stupid. It is to bring every single potential solution that crops into your head and just firing them out. If you put them in the chat, and then we'll bring some people on, if you can share your audio and video, to come and chat through some of those ideas. So for a quick 2 minutes, adding in all of the different potential solutions. Marcella, still on the barriers, but fantastic, thank you. Lack of time to manage social media accounts, apps for managing social media accounts, social media as latter, fantastic, yes. Apps are definitely a solution. Lack of time is an interesting one, because several people have mentioned that. Lack of time to manage social media accounts. Because social media is a massive tool, can be a massive tool. But Jesus, can it also be a burden? Like the level of time commitment and engagement that you need to have when it comes to understanding social media is a massive issue. So how can we solve these solutions? So again, for 2 minutes, have a quick think and write down every single potentially crazy, potentially innovative, potentially out there solution that you can come to dealing with one or more of these barriers. We've got some solutions coming in already. Remember, we've got 2 minutes. Round them off. But include youth in the process of making posts, videos, and so forth. So youth voice, that idea of youth voice, fantastic. Solution, apps for managing social media. Engage volunteers in content creation. Fantastic. Zoran, avoid cringe. I love how the word cringe is gaining traction in this chat. Thank you, Zoran. Recruiting young, cool people, maybe civic influencers that Diana is creating. So Diana, looks like you've got your next mission for your civic influencers. You've got 40 seconds left to write in any other solutions that come in. More money to promote, interesting. Okay, now they're coming in quick and fast. Love it. You got 15 seconds, no pressure. 3, 2, 1. Fantastic, that is 2 minutes. We've got some great solutions. Obviously, if you're writing your final solution, then put it in the chat you write, if you've still got one that you're writing, obviously add it into the chat. Just starting from some of these, avoid cringe, recruit young people, we already talked about that one. Taja, have a discussion with parents about digital usage to find out what their fears are. Interesting, so tackling the fears head on. Whilst I read out these, if anybody wants to share audio and video and talk about their solution, how would we do that? So for example, so Taja, how would we have a discussion with the parents about digital usage to find out their fears? How would you envisage doing that? Let's start to flesh out some of these solutions, and let's hear and discuss these. Yes, Taja, hello.
Hi, yeah, because I come from a space where we engage with parents and they see us in, I think it's easier if you have this kind of connection. They know us, they know who we are. So I imagine if we are giving them maybe some new kind of community in the digital world, that we also approach them like physically, because we have their numbers, we know where they live, they know where we are, and maybe just talk about them, what their fears are.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, definitely, definitely. Thank you. Thank you very much, Taja, for that. Diana mentions a lack of time to manage social media accounts, having different people managing different social media accounts. And Olga saying, give more importance to management of social media among the team. Olga or Diana, I'd love to hear from you both as to how you'd implement that kind of solution. And would that be a solution you'd be taking back to your NGO, to your organizations? Your respective organizations, of course. Diana, hi.
Hi again. So what we've learned from several workshops on social media is that it's better to have a different voice on each platform, because your voice on Facebook is not the same voice as on social media, as on Instagram stories. So and also, if you have one person taking care of social media in general, they will get exhausted really fast, because it's very tiring to just post, even post only once a day. In this way, we assign different volunteers in our team or to our core team or different channels. So, so in this way, you have a different vision and fresh content, and people don't get so tired about it. If even like this, they get tired and don't have time, but it is a solution, at least.
No, definitely. And is this something that you do? You implemented this already, isn't it? This is something that you're doing already.
Yeah.
As an organization. Yeah. Amazing. Thank you. Olga, yes. You were talking about giving importance to social media, giving more importance to management of social media. Tell us a bit more about that.
Yeah, it's actually a kind of solution for my team and for my organization. I think that the problem that we are facing is lack of really belief that it is important to be really active and effectively active online. So, we say people in the team are used to say we have no time. But in fact, it's not about the time, but importance. And I think that we should just give more attention to planning the work of the team and really reserve time and money for this this aspect of our activity, and also learn it, really learn it. And that's, I think that's very important. And I also mentioned proofreading. So it's obvious that when you are addressing, when you are adult and addressing your content to a public, you should be really aware of how to write precisely and to be well understood. So I think the young people we work for, can also be a part of our team as proof readers, and also paid, as you mentioned, Matteo. It is important not for just glory and volunteering and so, but also as a paid staff of our team.
Yeah, no, definitely. Unfortunately, glory and exposure are great, but they don't pay the bills, unfortunately. But yeah, no, thank you very much, Olga. That's amazing and really, really important points for that. Marcella mentioned the solution to be apps for managing social media, and that's quite a lot of you have mentioned. There are, you know, social media can be massively time consuming, and using tech solutions essentially to resolve this time problem could be one of the solutions. And Marcella, I'm wondering if you wanted to share your audio and video and talk to us about that solution. How did you, I mean, is it something that you're implementing in your organization? Do you have certain tech solutions that you've come across for managing social media that might be of use? I mean, for us as an organization, we currently use Hootsuite and TweetDeck for Twitter specifically. Not endorsing them, TweetDeck's pretty good. Hootsuite's not great, but we've struggled to find others that are better. So if you have any suggestions or solutions, that's a really good one. But Marcella, I don't know if you're still here or can hear us, but do feel free to share your audio and contribute on any suggestions or how you're finding that as well. That'd be amazing. Kaja said, accept our reality in the digital space. Let's just accept it and move on. Yeah, pretty firebrand approach, but fair enough. Marcella, upset at you, can you? Ah, Marcella, hi. Hi, welcome. No. hello. We can hear you.
Okay, perfect. I use later for this managing different app. The truth is, in my organization, Mar de Colores, we don't use so many media. We only use Facebook, but I work in different organizations and used to work with later for this. So, for example, on Sunday, I take 1 or 2 hours to programming all the week for put all the posts in the. But our biggest problem is the lack of interest for the kids, especially in Germany. There are not so fun of the use telephone or even computer, and the parents are really, really afraid to the use of and the exposure. So, for example, we had this course for this workshop for programming in Arduino. And it's free for the kids, and we send by email all the material, and it's online. And we had like 5 people just. So it's so difficult to achieve this. I don't know how to say it. Sorry, my English.
No, not a problem. But yeah, the parents thing is an interesting one, because a lot of people. Well, a few people in the chat mentioned it, and it is something that is, I would say, a barrier, but also potentially an opportunity. And I was wondering what you thought about that, because, you know, parents obviously have concerns, but engaging with them can potentially bring them on side, and therefore removing that barrier, but also potentially creating some allies within parenting communities that might strengthen your mission or your programs potentially.
Yeah.
Possibly. Maybe.
Okay. Thank you.
No worries. Thank you, Marcella. I also mentioned that I wanted to wondering if Alan would like to share your audio and video as well, because you mentioned avoiding looking at them as children. They need to feel like equals, which I think is super important. but something that we sometimes forget, that, you know, it's important to treat this next generation as equals. They have skills that we don't have. They have ideas that we can't think of. And we've got to treat them equally. We've got to treat them with respect, and also ensuring that they are equal, that we give them a chance. So that's a fantastic point, Alan, if you wanted to share your audio and video and come on and show. And I also saw that another comment from yourself. So grabbing attention in 1 to 2 seconds due to the general reduced attention span. And I think it's construction going on. Unfortunately, can't talk. No worries, Adam. No worries. But these are both fantastic points, like ensuring that I'm going to try and talk for you, Adam. Let me know if I've misquoted anything. But making sure that they're equals is super important. And also, I mean, how to deal with that level of that level of attention span is problematic. Like being able to turn around and say, yes, we're going to try and engage this person between, you know, 1 to 3 seconds before they scroll past your post is a barrier, is a problem. And how do we resolve that? Is it about targeting content? Is it about something else? I mean, I want to open up the floor to anybody now on this. How do we potentially deal with that barrier that Alan mentioned of ensuring that we try and grab their attention within the first couple of seconds? Again, if you want to talk about that or any bring up any other solutions, then please by all means let me know. So let me know that I've got 5 minutes. Fantastic, thank you. Any last questions or anything like that before we move on to the final speedy section? We'll obviously pitch your best solutions. And I want you to take a quick moment just to think about some of these solutions in the last couple of closing minutes of this workshop, just to think about any of these solutions that have been mentioned by all of the participants, by myself or anybody else, and just see how many of these solutions can you take back? Now, what's the one solution that you're saying, yes, I can take that back to my NGO? And that's something that we can constructively deal with or build on. So just a couple of minutes just to have a think about that. And whilst you're thinking about it, is there anyone else that has any questions for myself around any of the presentation? Feel free to get in touch with me. My email should now be on your screen. If anybody wants to share any final thoughts, please share your audio and video. You've got a couple of minutes left. Share any final thoughts or any final solution that you are going to take back to your organization. In the meantime, whilst unless there's anybody else that wants to say anything, I want to just say a quick massive thank you to TechSoup. Oh no, it's just Francesco. It's not just Francesco, you're amazing. Ben, I just want to say a massive thank you to all of you for joining me this morning today. Massive thank you to TechSoup for organizing this amazing Changemaker camp. I'll probably be heading towards the networking later on. But just lastly, thank you so much. I will be sharing my presentation, and I'm going to try and find, I'm going to try and give myself a 3 minute timer to try and find that TikTok educational page as well.